And turn with me to Psalm 133. Psalm 133, and you can hold your place there in Psalm 133. I guess if I were to title, which I tried to do for the sake of letting people know what we are addressing and for the sake of putting it out on the internet and things like that, a title of the message this morning, it would be The Blessing of Unity. And as I was looking through Dr. Zimek's outline, what he did, and he is the one of the professors at the Expositor Seminary down in Jupiter, who I was privileged to have lunch with, he and his wife Judy, last Sunday. And he has a book where he has outlined all the 150 Psalms. And as I was looking, in fact, early this morning, I didn't have his book with me. So this morning as I came into church, I just grabbed it off the shelf to look at it. And I had written my title, and so I took something he had written in his outline and wrote it to the side kind of at the last moment this morning, where he had titled this psalm, and I really do like his title better than mine. I titled it The Blessing of Unity. He titles it The Preciousness of True Fellowship. And indeed, this psalm addresses that issue. It seems as though if you stop for a moment and think about it. In fact, what I did was I brought this. This is the first book of the exposition of Psalms that we did. We started back, believe it or not, our first time was January of 2013 when we began our exposition in the Psalms. And so that's the first notebook. And then this is the second notebook. And this is just the notes on Psalm 119, which I haven't even finished yet. And so we've been in the Psalms. It seems as though we've been out of them, however, for a long time, because as I told you when I began the exposition back in January of 2013, that I would take periodically breaks to address other issues. And late spring and early summer kind of initiated a change up, as I just addressed with you guys, in the preaching schedule for the elders and myself. And so this change up postponed my exposition of the Psalms, specifically my exposition of Psalm 119, which I will return to Psalm 119, and I promise I will finish it. I just cannot promise you when I'll finish it. But if it is any consolation, we are almost at the end of Psalm 119. I think we have, if I look back at the notebook, we finished the last. Remember, Psalm 19 is divided into 22 stanzas. And the last time we were together in Psalm 119, we were in stanza 15. So we've only got about 7 more stanzas of that psalm that we will look at. So we are probably, 2/3 of the way or more done with the psalm. But this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to return to the Psalms, but I want us, rather than go to one Psalm 119 to pick up there, I want us to look at another Psalm, Psalm 133. And as you've turned there in your Bibles, let me follow with me as I read this brief but very rich Psalm. Follow very closely as I'm reading. If you have a pew Bible, it's page 519. If you've got your Bible, you're probably already there. Psalm 133, verse 1. Behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard, of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Let's bow our heads. Father, again, we are so blessed this morning to be together in this place as your body, those who you have called by your grace, who have been saved through faith in Jesus Christ. As we have gathered here as the body of Christ this morning and we have opened your word, I pray, Lord, that you would capture our hearts, that you would capture our thoughts, that we would be able to set aside and dismiss everything from our minds now that would in any way hinder or distract us from receiving from you all that you, by your Spirit, through your word, would speak to us today. And I ask your blessings to be upon us in this time that we are in your word. May it be rich for our souls and might it further accomplish your will and purpose in our lives for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may or may not recall that in the beginning of our exposition of Psalms, again, I'm thinking back to how long ago it was when we began this, and the ground that we have covered and the Psalms that we have been in, even though we haven't been in an enormous number of the 150 Psalms that make up the longest book in the Bible, the Psalter. But I told you that the 150 Psalms are also called the Psalter or the Psalter of Israel, and it was assembled into one book. So it's actually what we call the Psalter, but in reality, it's five books. It's five progressive stages of books that were compiled over an extended period of time, a long period of time. And there's more. I know that you know this, and I don't want to insult your intelligence, that David is not the author of all 150 Psalms. In fact, there are multiple authors of the different Psalms, many of them. We address some of them in our introduction to the Psalms. And so the five books, and you'll notice in your Bible, if you have a study Bible, that when you get to a new section that is actually a new book, it will say above that section, Book 2, Book 3, usually in Roman numerals, Book 4, and Book 5. But it's ordered in this manner in case you don't know it. In fact, Book 1 is Psalms 1 through 41. Then in Book 2, it is Psalms 42 through 72. And then in Book 3, it's Psalm 73 through Psalm 89. And then in Book 4, Psalms 90 through Psalms 106. And then in Book 5, which is the last book, is Psalm 107 through 150. So there you have the breakdown of the Psalms. And so Psalm 133 as well as Psalm 119 are part of what we call Book 5. In fact, if you look a few verses back up to Psalm, or a few Psalms back up to 107, you'll see probably above Psalm 107 where it says Book 5. And so that's the last book that was compiled to make the Psalter of Israel. And so within the five books, they're kind of subdivisions even within. So you have the one Psalter, you have the five books, and then you have subdivisions that are in those particular books. And they come in what we are called, or what is often called among students of the Bible, clustered Psalms. These groupings of Psalms are what we call clusters, and they're compiled and arranged in consecutive order and are connected. Here's what connects them. They're connected by a similar theme. And so you may find in a particular book that there are various Psalms that cover different themes, but then when you get to a particular cluster of Psalms, you will see that they are clustered by virtue of a particular theme. Our particular psalm today, Psalm 133, while a part of Book 5, is also a part of a cluster of psalms, which you may see well in your Bible, titled the Psalms of Ascent. And last week, I had the privilege of visiting our sister church in Jupiter, which I just spoke to you about, Grace Emmanuel Bible Church. And I had really looked forward when I made plans to go to be with Pastor Jerry and to be with Pastor Todd and Dr. Zimick and Bob and the others from the seminary there and worship with them. And I learned early that Jerry was on a trip to Israel. And he had taken 50 people from his church on a trip to Israel, his first time there, I think, since the early 80s. And they actually were not in Israel on Sunday. They were in Athens. They had already finished their tour of Israel and made their way to Athens. And Jerry had just finished preaching at Mars Hill when he addressed the congregation via Skype. And it was outstanding. I loved the way at 25 of the group had already returned home and 25 had remained, and they were still in Athens, and they'd make their way home, probably got home the end of the week. I loved it at the end. They have two services. Both services are filled. You could hardly find a park in the parking lot. And the congregation all turned to the back of the church where the camera was and told him they loved him and they missed him. And it was tremendous. But in his place, Pastor Todd, who will be doing the youth camp, was actually preaching. And I was excited when he gave us the subject on which he was going to be teaching us or preaching to us. It was out of Psalm 115. And that psalm is a part of another cluster of psalms in the Psalter known as the Hallelujah Psalms, or the Psalms of Hallelujah. And in fact, they are Psalms 111 through 113, and then 115 through 117, in Psalm 146 through Psalm 150. Now, each of the hallelujah psalms or psalms of hallelujah or psalms of praise begin in our English translation, you will notice, with these words, praise the Lord. Now, in the original Hebrew, that is literally one word. And it's a word that we commonly refer to as hallelujah. We know it. But it's a compound word from hallel, which means praise, and from the title, name of God, Yahweh. So hallel, Yahweh, or hallelujah, or praise the Lord. And so this term expresses a soul. This hallelujah expresses a soul that is caught up or enraptured in praise to Yahweh. Now, in light of our psalm this morning in Psalm 133, the reason for the title Psalms of Ascent, which that is a Hallel psalm or Hallelujah psalm, the one I just mentioned to you, Psalm 115. But now 133 is a group of clusters known as Psalms of Ascent, A-S-C-E-N-T. You'll notice that in your Bibles. It's because these psalms were actually psalms that were sung by Jewish pilgrims as they made their way up to Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem sits at about 2,700 feet in elevation. But it doesn't matter where you're coming from. Most of you already know this. No matter what direction you are coming from, if you are going to Jerusalem, you are said to be going up to Jerusalem. It doesn't matter. And so even though it sits at elevation, whenever pilgrims would make their way there, they would always be going up to Jerusalem, and they would be singing these hymns, these songs, these psalms as they were making their way to Jerusalem. It's like 115 that Todd preached on last Sunday was very interesting, because being a hallelujah psalm, it is traditionally believed that prior to going into the garden and being arrested, Psalm 115 was the very psalm the disciples, led by Jesus, were singing as they left the Last Supper. And so these are psalms that they would actually sing, and this psalm is no exception. And they would sing this psalm on three prescribed occasions when they would make their way up to Jerusalem. These three occasions would be three feasts. The first would be the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The second would be the Feast of Weeks or Pentecost or the Feast of Harvest. And then the third would be the Feast of Ingathering, which is also called the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. Now, of the Psalms of Ascent, David is credited as the author of four of them. In fact, Spurgeon, when writing his commentary on the Psalms, addressing the Davidic authorship of the psalm, wrote this, and I quote him, quote, "We see no reason for depriving David of the authorship of this sparkling sonnet." And indeed, we'll see this morning that it is that. In fact, Spurgeon's reasoning is understandable in light of this psalm's dealing with unity. And the reason that I say that, who is more fitting? Think with me for a moment. Who is more fitting to write of the importance of unity than David? And the reason being, I'll give you in just a moment, is that that was something of tremendous significance to him. Again, the Prince of Preachers writes this. He says, "He," speaking of David, "knew by experience," and listen to this, "knew by experience the bitterness occasioned by divisions, and was well prepared to celebrate in choicest psalmody the blessing of unity for which he sighed," end of quote. In fact, why do I say that? Why does Spurgeon say that? Because division marked David's own household. In fact, David's sons were antagonistic toward one another. We know the story. For example, there's Absalom, who in 2 Samuel chapter 13, verses 28 through 33, murdered Amnon. And in 1 Kings 1, 5 through 53, we see Adonijah tries to deny Solomon's right to the throne of his father David. Not to mention Absalom's insurrection against David himself, causing him to actually flee from Jerusalem. We see that in 2 Samuel 15 and following, until chapter 18, when Absalom is finally killed. So David's house is known for its division, known for its strife, which I again find amazing that this is the man who the New Testament reveals to us was the man after God's own heart. And yet, even though this psalm was written prior to those events actually taking place, it really does establish for us the importance of unity to David. So David writing this particular psalm, it is safe to assume that David was well aware of the importance of unity nationally and later in regards to his family, familial relationships. So as we read this psalm, even though it is very short, only three verses, not many of the psalms are this brief, some are, but this is a very brief psalm. It's very short. We quickly notice something that there is. If you read those three verses again that I just read to you, you'll notice that there is not a single hint, not a single hint of any negativity in this psalm. Not one single hint. In fact, Spurgeon writes, quote, "No wrye," that's an old English word, "no wrye word. All is," and I love the terminology he uses, "all is sweetness and light," end of quote. Occasionally it's good to read something like that, right, where there's not a hint of negative, not a hint of rebuke, not a hint of, not, I don't want to say conviction, because conviction is here, that's not necessarily negative, but nothing negative here. And as this psalm would be sung as the pilgrims were making their way up to Jerusalem, about to return to the holy city, this may very well have been their hymn of joy as the tribes prepared to gather at the common altar and worship Yahweh. This psalm speaks contextually of Israel's unity in their worship to the one true living God. So the divisions and differences among the tribes were laid aside at this particular point because they were coming together up to Jerusalem. And despite their differences and their distinctives, they would be in unison singing this psalm, giving God the glory in their worship to the living God. So there is a very important principle to note here. And listen very carefully. Men strive relentlessly for unity, seeking every possible means to bring about unity. Sadly, as we have witnessed in this world, to no avail. In fact, I was thinking as I was writing this message of that exercise of futility that occupies a limited amount of space in New York City known as the United Nations. You know, that organization that was to end all world conflicts and bring all the nations together in a unified effort of peace and unity. And it is a miserable failure. Since when do peacekeeping forces have to live in tanks and carry armored weapons as they go around the world? Doomed from the beginning. And the reason that it was doomed from the beginning is because it was man's attempt in his own wisdom and in his own strength to bring about unity. And as a result, all they get is disunity and disharmony because they're doing it in their own power and they're doing it in their own strength. In fact, in his book, The Pursuit of God, a book that many of you, I'm sure, have read or seen over the years by A.W. Tozer, gave the following illustration. I love this illustration. He says this, listen, he says, suppose, I'm paraphrasing it. He says, suppose you have 100, and some of you can appreciate this, Joe and other musicians among us. Suppose you have 100 concert pianos. 100 concert pianos. And they all need to be in tune with one another. Now, if you tune the second piano to the first, the third piano to the second, the fourth piano to the third, and so on until you have tuned all 100 pianos accordingly, what would you have? Would you have tune? The reality of the matter, and Rudy knows this as well, you would have nothing but disunity and disharmony. Now, what is the problem there? What's the problem? Yes, what's the problem? Why can't I do that? I remember as a little boy, I was thinking about this illustration, which is off the wall here a little bit. I was thinking, I loved building my first doghouse. Some of you guys can appreciate this. And so I didn't have a tape measurer. And so I just kind of guessed the size I wanted a doghouse. So I cut the first board the length of that I thought the doghouse needed to be. And not having a tape measure, I took the first board and laid it on the second board and marked it. Some of you know where I'm going, right? And then I laid the second on the third board and marked it. And by the time I got my 8 or 10 boards on one side, the top was here and the bottom was here. And I'm going, I wonder what happened. Well, here's the problem. The problem is that you have used something that you should not have used. You attempted to cut, or I attempted to tune the pianos with one another. That was the problem. However, if you tuned each piano, again, listen, musicians, if you tuned each piano to the same tuning fork, you tuned one by the tuning fork, and after having that one tuned, you took the same tuning fork and went to the second piano and tuned that one by the second one. When you had tuned 100, all 100 of the pianos by the same tuning fork, and then came to play them together, what would you experience? Harmony. And you would experience unity because each of the pianos have been tuned to the same fork. What application, think with me for a moment, what application does this have to the church? What application does this have to the body of Christ? Tozer goes on to argue this, that when believers try to tune themselves to one another, are you ready? Are you listening? When we try to tune ourselves to one another, it is going to result in disharmony. But when each saint, and here's the key, listen closely, when each saint brings himself or herself into one accord with Jesus Christ, what happens to the unity and the harmony that exists in the church? It's beautiful. Because each individual believer is tuning himself or tuning herself to the Lord Jesus Christ. While contextually this psalm is applied or is actually addressing the sweetness, I love the words of Spurgeon there, the sweetness of unity among the children of Israel in their worship of Yahweh, in a broader, think with me, in a broader and equally significant application, it addresses unity among all God's people who are truly in communion with God the Father through Jesus Christ, His Son. In fact, the Apostle Paul wrote of such unity in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13, where he wrote concerning the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. That is what God's desire for us is, as that we come together in the unity of the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God. And so the Lord Jesus himself established this ground rule. Think with me for a moment. Established this ground rule in John chapter 5. Beginning in verse 19 of John chapter 5. Remember, he's healed a blind man on the Sabbath, and it has caused a controversy. The Jews have rebuked him for dare performing a miracle on the Sabbath. And so he says, which is more difficult, for me to heal a man or to forgive him of his sins? And so that sparks a controversy. And immediately following that, he goes into this brief conversation, in reality equating himself with God for those who doubt that Jesus ever put himself on level with God. He equates himself with God in the verses following verse 19 in the healing of the blind man, making himself equal with God. And then in verse 23, he establishes, in fact, following that, he establishes his own authority as the Son of God. And in verse 23 of chapter 5 of John, he says this, quote, that all may honor the Son. Now listen carefully. All may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Honor the Son just as you honor the Father. And then he adds this, which further solidifies the content of the statement. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Now, if you look at that word honor is literally the same word that could be interpreted as worship. So those who would come and claim, for example, the friendly missionaries that knock on your door on Saturday morning that think you are wrong because you have the audacity to worship Jesus rather than worship Jehovah alone, the reality of the matter is, if we fail to worship Jesus, we are in reality failing to worship the Father. And that is exactly what Jesus is saying, and that's the truth that he establishes for us. So this psalm has tremendous implications. Psalm 133 is not just for those who are making their way up to Jerusalem to celebrate, but it has tremendous implications for the church. Our English translations even title this psalm. If you've got a Bible with subtitles, you'll notice it, that they're titled things like blessed or blessed unity of the people of God, or the benefit of the communion of saints, or when brothers dwell in unity. However you title the psalm, however you title it, the meaning is exactly the same. It is a song about unity among God's people, which is essential. And what this psalm does, in this brief psalms, verses 2 and 1, 2 and 3, I'm thinking one for something else in just a moment, but in verses 2 and 3, the psalmist employs two means to develop the theme about this unity, the means of proclamation and also the means of a picture, an illustration for us. So let's look at the psalm and let's break it down. Now that I've gotten through the introduction, I told you I didn't want to give you false hope, right? I think I can move relatively quickly, though. But look at the opening word. Look at the very first word of Psalm 133. He says, "Behold." Now, when we read our English translation, we may very well just read that word and then move right on as quickly as we possibly can to what we think would be the significant things that are trying to be said are going to be said there. But behold is important because behold means, it means pause. It means gaze upon something. What one is looking at or about to see is worthy of special attention. Behold. If someone says that to you, you stop in your tracks and you look, you gaze at something because it's worthy of admiration. It's worthy of special attention. Now, what is about to be seen is truly a precious thing. What the psalmist is about to address is truly a special thing, and it's worth noting well. Now, what is this precious thing worth beholding, something worth having our attention? And David goes on to say that it is something, look at the next words, that is good and pleasant. In fact, he says, how good. If you have the King James Version in front of you, it says how good and how pleasant. It uses that word how two times. The English Standard Version only uses it once. It says how good and pleasant it is. It is of such excellence, of such notoriety, that the psalmist prefaces good and pleasant with how. Another way of saying exceedingly good, exceedingly pleasant is what I'm about to say to you, about to speak to you. Behold how good, behold how pleasant it is. In fact, again, Spurgeon notes on this, it says, quote, the combination of the two adjectives, good and pleasant, is more remarkable than the conjunction of two stars of the first magnitude. For a thing to be good is good, but for it to also be pleasant is better. In other words, he's saying for something to be good is one thing, but for the author to say not only is it good, but it is pleasant is something altogether more. He says all men love pleasant things. Amen? And yet it frequently happens that when they are pleasant, they are evil or pleasurable, they're evil. But here the condition is as good as it is pleasant and as pleasant as it is good. End of quote. How good and how pleasant. And so again, I ask the question, what is this precious thing worth beholding, worth admiring, worth stopping and gazing upon? What is this thing that is exceedingly good and exceedingly pleasant as it is good? And the psalmist doesn't keep us in expense. Look what he says here. He jumps right into it. How good and how pleasant it is. And here it is. When brothers dwell in unity. When brothers dwell together in unity. Let's break this down. I love to do that. And first, we notice the word brothers. Now, the old English word, if you have the King James Version in front of you, is the word brethren. And I should note, I should not have to inform you that David is not speaking merely of siblings. I mean, it's a pretty good thing if brothers in the household do get along with each other. It's miserable if they don't or sisters don't get along. But David is not limiting this to sibling relationships or physical relationships. Brothers by birth or brothers according to the flesh. This word transcends natural relationships. Here, brothers, not to exclude sisters. I'm using the word brothers because I'm reading to you the scriptures, but I'm not excluding you ladies. Don't think as I'm leaving you out. But here, brothers, not to exclude sisters, are brothers in spirit. And more specifically, brothers spiritually by virtue of what? By virtue of our common faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit. In fact, Romans chapter 8, verses 14 through 16 says this. It says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. You have received the Spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Now, just think with me for a moment through this. If we are sons of God, if I am a son of God, and if you are a son of God, now, ladies, again, don't think I'm excluding you. I have no problem being the bride of Christ. You should have no problem being a son of God. But if we are sons of God by virtue of our adoption, then listen, we are spiritually related to one another. You know who's sitting beside you this morning, who's sitting in front of you, who's sitting behind you? If they are truly have a true relationship with Jesus Christ, they've been saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone, you are related to them. You may not have the same blood coursing through your veins. You may not have the same DNA, but I tell you, you are, I would say, more profoundly related to them than by those natural means. Because what we do have common in each and every one of us, as children of God, we have the residency of the person of the Holy Spirit. The same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is the same Spirit that lives in you and lives in everyone else in this congregation that is your brother and sister in Christ. And that's what he's talking about. It is, brothers is the most common New Testament description of that relationship. Brothers, or brotherhood. Second only to the Apostle Paul, the Apostle John, in his first epistle speaks just candidly of believers as brothers. Paul uses that over. Look, just take your concordance and look up brother, brothers, brethren, and see how often the Apostle Paul uses that terminology. And then look down and find 1 John. Paul speaks of brotherly love. John speaks of brotherly love. In fact, he speaks of brotherly love in Romans chapter 12, verse 10. Then the author of Hebrews instructs us to let brotherly love continue. Hebrews 13, 1. And the Apostle Peter in 1 Peter 2, 17 says this. He says, love the brotherhood and fear God. And so you see the importance of brothers. He says, when brothers, those who are in relationship with one another by virtue of their saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And next we see the word dwell. Now, when you think of word dwell, it's a word normally that we use in reference to residence. And while we do not live or dwell together in the same place at all times, in other words, we're not going to leave this place and all go to one home together. We will go to our various places, that where we dwell in regards to our residence. So while we don't live together or dwell together in the same place at all times, nevertheless, and I want you to try to get this principle, our constant togetherness, are you ready for this? Our constant togetherness is not in a residence other than our residing in Christ. That's where we commonly dwell together in Christ. While we may part company physically, we never part company in regards to our residence in Christ. We are always together in our relationship with Him. Boy, that should just resound within our minds and in our hearts. Even though we might be separated by distance, although we might be separated by circumstances, we are not separated in regards to our relationship spiritually with one another, because we are never separated from our relationship with God. And so we are in constant fellowship with one another because our fellowship is in Christ. In fact, 1 John chapter 1, verse 3, the Apostle John writes this in his first epistle. He says, quote, indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his son, Jesus Christ. That's the foundation for our fellowship, our relationship with one another. So the nature of our fellowship, our togetherness, is that which is worth beholding. It is our unity. He says, when brothers dwell together or dwell in unity. So here's what he's saying is worth looking at. Here's what is good. Here is what is pleasant. Not merely that you are brothers, but that you dwell together. How? In a state of unity. You are together. To dwell together is to function in close and intimate association with one another. And we are to do so in unity. I remember years and years and years ago back in Bible college, one of my fellow students had begun pastoring a small church that was struggling, and he was having issues within his small congregation. I remember him saying to me one time, he said, you know, Mitch, church would be a great place if it wasn't for people. And I remember saying to him, you know, in my naive way, but Randy, if you didn't have people, you wouldn't have the church. And he laughed and said, I guess you're right. Unity is not, and listen carefully, unity is not uniformity. We are not all alike. Praise God that we are not exactly alike. We have distinctions. We have differences, and those differences are not bad. Those differences are not evil. They don't make anyone less than anyone else. But our differences, our distinctives, should not serve to divide us. In fact, look with me in your Bibles. Hold your place in Psalm and turn with me to the book of Romans for a moment. And I will look at these passages because I want you, if you don't already have them marked, to mark them in your Bible. But if you look at Romans chapter 12, verses 3 through 6a, the first part of verse 6, let's read what it says. Romans chapter 12, beginning at verse 3, reading through verse 6a. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. For by the grace given to me, I say to every one among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them. Stop. So what do you see? That though we are one body, we are individual members of the body, right? And as individual members of the body, we differ according to the grace that God has given to us. We are different and distinctive because of God's work in each and every one of our lives. Remember, I said to you some time ago, I had a conversation with a dear brother who had just left a place where he was told by a guy who claims to be a Christian. He said, well, you know, I don't need to go to church because I am the church. And this brother looked at me and said, and he's right, isn't he, Pastor Mitch? And I just said, no, he's not right. I said, because if he's right, then what do you do with passages like Romans chapter 12? What do you do with passages like 1 Corinthians chapter 12, which we'll look at just in a moment? You can turn your finger there now. If he is a church, is he all the members? Is he all the individual members himself? Is he totally self-sufficient as the members of the body of Christ? No, we are a body made up of what? Members, plural. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, look at what Paul says again in regards to this in verses 14 through 20. He says, and this blows that whole theory of thought out of the water. He says this, for the body does not consist of one member, but of many. That right there disproves that theory, that he is the church. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged, and notice this, God arranged the members in the body. God arranged the members in the body, each of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, many parts, yet what? Yet one body. Differences and distinctives do not equate with disharmony and disunity. Our differences, our distinctives make us fully functioning as a body or fully functioning as a brotherhood. Can I say this to you this morning? And I make no apologies for making this statement. I need you for who you are and for what God has made you. I don't need you to be anything else but what God has made you. Because if you are what God has made you, you're being what God has made you, then you are fulfilling your part in the functioning body. Rather than trying to conform everyone to a particular notion or idea or whatever it might be or distinctive. It makes us a fully functioning body and should display our unity. It should display our harmony. We dwell together in unity of support. We dwell together in unity of fellowship. And most of all, we dwell together in the unity of love. Our unity is held together by this, by our mutual affection and by our mutual love for one another. You have to ask yourself the question. Yes, I know that person sitting next to me. Now, if it's your wife or spouse, you better really say this. Now, I know that that person sitting next to me or that person sitting in front of me or sitting behind me is indeed my brother or sister in Christ. It is a whole nother thing altogether to say, not only do I acknowledge and recognize that they are that, but that I love them. I truly love them. Listen, I don't know how uncomfortable it makes you, but we should not ever, 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 ever be uncomfortable looking at our brothers and sisters in Christ eye to eye and saying, I love you. I love you. Because that is literally that which holds us together. It is our mutual affection, our mutual love for one another. We are first and foremost to love one another. I don't know that it is true, but tradition has taught us through church history. The Apostle John was the last of the apostles to pass away. In fact, he was the only of the original apostles who did not suffer a martyr's death but died naturally. And it is reported by those who were with him at his death in his 90s. That his last words to those, and I find this not very surprising, but his last words to those who were present with him at his death was this, as he looked at them and through a labored breathing voice he spoke to them, brothers, love one another. If indeed that's true, I find it not hard to believe if you read his epistles. Because what does he tell you over and over and over and over and over again to do what? To love one another. If you say you love God and don't love your brother, you're a liar. Pretty strong words. A church that enjoys such unity is, as Spurgeon says, and again, I love his flowery expressions here. He says, quote, a well of goodness and joy to those who dwell round about it. It's not just good to those who are in the midst of it. Isn't it sweet to be in a place where there's unity? Isn't it sweet to be in a place where there is mutual affection for one another? It's not only pleasant for us, it's pleasant for all those who are touched by us. By this, Jesus said, will all men know you are my disciples because you wear navy blue pinstripe suits. Or you have the same type of haircut, or you have the same translation of the Bible sitting in your lap, right? No. By this will all men know that you are my disciples. You do what? Come on. You love one another. You love one another. To go back to Tozier's illustration of the pianos, how good, how pleasant it is to those who are in a place where each piano, in this case, each brother and each sister have been tuned by the same tuning fork, the Spirit of the living God. Romans 5:5. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. It's not only good to man, that's one thing. It is pleasant also to God. It is good to man, it is pleasant to man. But it also is good to God and pleasant to God. And to me, that's what really matters. In verses 2 and 3, the psalmist paints for us a very vivid picture of this unity. Look at what he says, and I'll move quickly through this. He says, it is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. Verse 3, it is like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. So the unity of the brotherhood, the unity of brethren, the unity of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is first likened here. And this is, as Dr. Zimmick says, this is the picture that he paints for us, the word picture. Is the Lord likened to the precious anointing oil poured on the head of Aaron, the high priest. Now, Aaron could not minister. Now, we think of anointing, those of you who perhaps have been in churches where they anoint, where they have a little bitty bottle and they put a little bit on their finger and they may rub a little bit on your forehead and they begin to pray. That is not the anointing the Bible's talking about. Can you imagine what would happen if some of these places would bring buckets of oil and just pour them on people? That's what it's talking about. And Aaron could not minister until he was anointed with the oil. And the anointing symbolized by the precious oil, which is a very fragrant thing, which was a holy thing. It was the oil of consecration, which was to be used only in the Lord's service. And what happened, this oil was poured on Aaron's head. It would literally run down his hair. It would run down his face. It would drench his beard. It would drench the collar of his robe until it drenched his entire robe, until it reached the very hems of his garments. He was drenched in oil. Then and only then was he consecrated for the Lord's service. And yet this is the very thing that David says is good and pleasant in the eyes of the Lord, is that is when that unity is like that oil that is just poured out on Aaron. The point of this illustration is to show that the oil was meant to flow. Look, it was meant to flow. Our unity is meant to flow. Though it was poured on his head, it covered his entire body. Get that picture in your mind of this man standing there after being anointed. He's drenched with this fragrant oil. This was not Missoula or Quaker State. This was oil ordered by God. The formula was ordered by God. And it was fragrant. And all those who witnessed this were not only awestruck by what they were seeing as his garments being drenched in the oil, but they were taken back by this glorious, sweet fragrance of this oil that was not only a sweet fragrance to their nostrils, but was what? A sweet fragrance in the nostrils of God, as is our unity. This is symbolic of a rich spiritual blessing. Where there is unity in the fellowship of believers, this blessing of harmony and Christian love spreads to the entire body. And it is good and pleasant to all who dwell there. And not only to those who dwell there, but I said to you a moment ago, all those who are somehow touched by us. But most of all, it's pleasing. In fact, most pleasant to the Lord Himself. And then finally, look at verse 3. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. You've got to picture this. I was just frustrated as I was writing this. I said, I know I'm going to be out of time already. I'm right. And yet that illustration, we could go back to Exodus and we could look at that illustration of the anointing. And that would be a wonderful teaching. And we also could look at this one about the dew on Hermon and how significant that is. And I just want you to go do some research. Get your Bible dictionaries out and look at this phrase and see what that is all about. It's rich. The word picture is beyond time this morning. I've never visited the Alps. Maybe some of you have. But I understand there are some places that you can be at the foot of the Alps where that cool, brisk wind or breeze moves over that snow-covered mountain and it comes down into the valleys, and it is just overwhelming with the sweetness and freshness that it brings from the top of the mountains. And that's what this picture paints. Falls on the mountain of Zion, where the Lord has commanded the blessing life forevermore. Not only is this unity like the precious oil, it is likened to the dew of Hermon. Mount Hermon is the tallest mountain peak in the Middle East. In fact, it stands over 9,000 feet. I think it's 9,232 feet exactly that it stands. And according to Bible scholars, nowhere in the whole country is so heavy a dew precipitable as in the districts near Mount Hermon. The water drops, which rose from the forest mantled heights of the mountain after encountering the sun's rays, would descend at evening time. Are you ready for this? As heavy drops of dew, almost like rain. And this dew was of such positive freshness that it seemed to be almost life-giving. Can you imagine being in a dry place, which down at the bottom they would be in a dry place, and then all of a sudden this dew would move off the mountain? In dry times, it would provide nourishment. The psalmist uses this vivid illustration to describe unity among God's people. It is like fragrant oil. It is like the very dew that comes off Mount Hermon. So far, we have two pictures of unity among God's people: anointing oil and falling dew. For there, look at the last part of verse 3. For there, where's there? For where there is such unity. For there, the Lord has commanded the blessing. That is powerful, folks. The Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Don't read over that. Don't miss that. God commands His blessing where there is unity and harmony. Unity and harmony are not non-essentials. Do you want God's blessing? Do we, as a church family, want God's blessings? Then we are to strive for this same unity. Because where there is this unity, where there is this harmony, guess what God does? God commands His blessings. That is why it is essential for the church, for a church, a local body of believers, to strive to create an environment of unity. Again, where brethren dwell in unity, where there is harmony, the Lord bestows His blessing. Lord, we want Your blessing. And what does this mean, commands His blessing? It means by sovereign decree. By sovereign decree. God sovereignly decrees, commands. In other words, God orders His grace to be bestowed where His people are united and in harmony. What a tremendous thought. That we are the recipients, or could be the recipients, or are the recipients of the grace of God that has been commanded as a blessing among us. That we could come together as the body of Christ here at Crosswalk and know that this is the place, or a place, where God has commanded His blessing. I feel that way. I feel that way about our fellowship. I feel that way about this church. I'm saying that with all my heart. It is the Holy Spirit that makes this possible among a people who are yielded to Him. And at the same time, the Father and the Son send the Spirit. In other words, we yield to the Spirit. And at the same time, the Father and the Son send the Spirit, the fullness of the Spirit, where unity is found. The blessing. What is the blessing? The blessing is God's favor. I don't seek the favor of men. We seek the favor of what? Of who? We seek the favor of God. The blessing is God's favor. The blessing is God's grace, the grace that He pours out on such a people. Oh, that we would strive and continue to strive, continue to pray, continue to cultivate such a place that we might further continually enjoy the blessings and the favor of God. And then he closes it with this. He says, life forevermore. Life forevermore. As one commentator put it, the stream of spiritual life which never ceases. Wednesday night we talked about eternity in our Bible study of 1 Peter. We're coming to a close. We talked about that unceasing, never ceases. And this is this life forevermore, this life that never ceases, is the antithesis of spiritual death. Where there is unity and harmony, there is spiritual life. Perpetual spiritual life. Unceasing spiritual life. Ongoing spiritual life. Where there is disunity and disharmony, there is spiritual death. And as I close, listen one more time to the earnest plea of our dear Prince of Preachers. And that's not me. That's Charles Spurgeon. Listen to what he says when he closes his commentary on this psalm. How rich. And I can hear him because I've listened to reenactments of his preaching by those who preach in his accent, who literally are from the country and preach in the country. And they take his sermons and they'll preach them and they'll record them. And as I listen to the passion behind their voices, I can sit sometimes and close my eyes and I can just hear him preaching. And as he's addressing his congregation at the Metropolitan Tabernacle, and he closes his exposition of this psalm this way, oh, for more of this rare virtue. Not the love which comes and goes, but that which dwells. Not the spirit which separates and secludes, but that which dwells together. Never shall we know the full power of the anointing till we are of one heart and of one spirit. Never will the sacred dew of the Spirit descend in all of its fullness till we are perfectly joined together. Lord, Lord, lead us into this most precious unity for thy Son's sake. Amen. Crossroad family, I love you. And so very much am I so grateful and thankful for the unity, for the harmony, and the love that exists here, which I think was demonstrated this past month when I was out of place, for your continued love and support, not only for this church, but for one another. May we strive to maintain that unity so that we may continue to enjoy the blessings of the Lord. Amen? May this place indeed be a place where the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore.